everyone. Good afternoon and welcome to our latest installment of PAC TV as part of our PAC in Your Living Room series, which can be found at www.artscenter.org. Of course, we regret that we can't be in the theaters serving you with wonderful performances right now, but we continue to have excellent opportunities to bring you inside the work that's going on via some of our amazing artist partners. If you look back, I've been fortunate enough to speak with Kyle Abraham and Doug Ferrone, and wonderful, wonderful artists. I want to point out that in the previous episodes, I've been coming to you from my home, but we are back on campus providing education. So I'm happy to tell you that I am here in the PAC in my office, and behind me is actually my vision board for how we build a season. So we're still working at it, even though times are difficult. I'm going to get right to it because we have a lot of great, great stuff to get to today. We are absolutely, absolutely thrilled to be joined by the brand new artistic director of the José Limón Dance Company, Dante Puleio. I'm going to bring Dante in right now. Hi, Dante. Thank you for being here with us.
Thanks for having me. I'm super excited about this.
Well, we're so glad to have you. Many of the audience knows that we had just had Limón here before the pandemic hit, and we were working on a really special partnership, as myself and your executive director, Juan José, spoke about from the stage. And so we're excited to continue, despite the limitations, to bring you to our audience, introduce you, and talk about how we're going to go forward and come back better. So I want to jump right in and talk to you about your new position. It's fantastic. It's been so well received in the industry. It's such a wonderful, wonderful choice. I think most of our contemporaries bring in someone who was from the company and someone who is as young as yourself. It's a really exciting thing. So the first question, you came aboard at the foundation as the artistic director this past July during, of course, what's a uniquely challenging time in our history and the history of the company and the performing arts at large. So what does it feel like to take the artistic reins of this legendary company during a time when we can't fill theaters and the sector is so challenged?
Yeah, it was a specific moment to get that call. I got the call actually in March. We had just gone into quarantine, I think maybe 2 or 3 days when Juan José called and shared the news. And because of everything that was going on, and because, you know, the need to shift right away and figure out a new way of operating, I just dove right in. The official title change happened in July, but we were working together that whole, all of those months to bring new classes to the, to Instagram, so we could have this free exchange. And then it started to become, okay, so this is going to last longer than just a couple of weeks. What does that look like now? So, of course, bringing in the Zoom classes and really focusing on education so we could continue to engage that way. And then we're like, okay, so what's next? How do we continue to engage not just in teaching, but also with performing? So we were fortunate enough that we were able to gather virtually. And restage There Is a Time, which we turned into a dance film, just an abridged version. And it was, terrifying to walk into this space in this whole new way, but super exciting because I wanted the company to move to a virtual platform anyway. And this moment just opened that invitation really wide. I was like, okay, so this is what we need to be doing. So that support was there from the foundation, from the dancers. So we were able to just go right into it. And, so far it's, every day is a new landscape to play with. So we just deal with what we're dealt and try to make the best of it.
That's great. Thank you, Dante. I want to follow up on that. When we were preparing for this conversation, you spoke to me about that actually you're seeing some silver linings here in terms of this being a unique moment to do things like upgrade your virtual platform, upgrade the web, upgrade social media. So how do you see the virtual fitting in, not just as a stopgap moment now, but in your long-term vision?
Yeah, we have been thinking about what this looks like in the future. So I think the planning from here on out, whenever we are considering our intensives, our performances. What does the virtual aspect of that look like? You know, we were able to have people from all over the world tune in to come and take class with us, come and see a performance in a way that they never were able to before. And how exciting is that? I was teaching a class on Instagram, and someone, you know, sent me a message right afterwards. I was like, oh, Dante, you know, are you Italian? I said, yeah, my grandfather was from a small village in Sicily. And the person I was speaking with, oh, really, where? And she said the name of the village. And I was like, oh, my grandfather was from San Pier Niceto. And she goes, that village is right next to mine. And it was just mind blowing. It's like, wow, I got to teach a dancer in Sicily next to the town where my grandfather grew up in Sicily. That would have never happened. So how do we keep doing that? By doing it, by continuing to make sure that every intensive we're talking about has a virtual component. All of our performances have a live stream or some kind of access that makes it available to more than just the people sitting in the theater that night.
I heard an absolutely heartwarming story from your executive director about frontline workers who are getting their bodies ready to go in and deal with the things that we need them desperately to deal with by taking your classes. Have you seen a lot of that? And how has that impacted you?
Yeah, you know, we got an email. It was like, we just want to thank you so much. Every day before I go into the hospital to work, I take this class at 3 o'clock because it sets me up. It like centers me in a way that, you know, some people need meditation. Some people need whatever self-care they need to prepare for whatever it is they have to dive into. Our class was able to do that for them. And yeah, like, like tear to the eye and like, wow, like that's what this is. You know, it's like dance is this community-based thing, and we're here to, you know, provoke change, but also offer comfort. And if we can do that with a class or with a performance, like, great. Like, that's exactly what I want to be doing.
That's wonderful. It was such a wonderful story. You and I spoke a lot about the balancing. You know, Limón is such an important legacy company for the dance world. And we spoke about that versus balancing the contemporary. And now we're in this unique virtual moment. So how do you see the relationship between Limón's tradition or the legacy and the need to reimagine work for a contemporary audience, both virtually and when we go back to the theater, bringing in, you know, both new choreographers and some classic choreographers? How do you balance that?
Yeah, there's a couple different fronts that we're looking at. So first, how do we present a bigger program? Who are we inviting in to talk about the works? Who are we inviting in to commission works on the company so that when their work is seen alongside Mesa Brevis, both of them make sense to live together in that moment? So maybe that's working with choreographers that dealt with similar issues that José dealt with. You know, José Limón grew up in a war-torn country. He saw his uncle shot and killed in front of him. He came to America, was bullied for not knowing the language. He had a relationship with Charles Wideman that was never talked about. He had his marriage to Pauline Lawrence that was celebrated, and he made a piece for her when she died. You know, there's so many different facets to who he was as a person. So when we're looking at commissioning choreographers, it's like, who was José? Why did he make the work? And who can we bring in now that can talk about their lives in a way that also supports what José has already created? And so that's one aspect. When we're looking at another aspect of bringing back these masterworks, you know, there's bringing them back to that original moment. Like, what was that first costume idea? What was that first choice of music? Was there a backdrop? How can we bring it back to that true historical sense of what it was made in the moment? And then we can also look at how can that work breathe and shift and evolve so it speaks to today. So like I was saying before, we did a virtual restaging or an excerpt restaging of There's a Time. And in that work is a section called Time to Speak and Time to Be Silent. That all was happening. We were restaging that during the protests. Black Lives Matter was on every single Facebook page, every single Instagram feed. You there was no ignoring that. And so we're working with this section of There Is a Time called Time to Speak. And it's like, this is what this is about. Like, when is it time to speak and when is it time to be silent? Like, who is it time for it to be silent for, and who is it a time for it to, like, who is supposed to be speaking right now? And it was such a revelatory moment to be able to take this work that was created in the 1950s and bring it right here to 2020 and be like, this work is talking about this moment. It is so universal and it is so a part of who we are and a part of this humanistic experience that it doesn't stop just because it was made in 1956, but it breathes and lives in 2020 and beyond. So how do we costume it? How do we look at it in a way that speaks to the next generation of artists and audiences who will continue to be the torchbearers of this legacy?
That's wonderful. So Dante, I want to shift to get to know you a little bit more. And we're here in an academic institution. We have a wonderful Conservatory of Dance. You're going to meet a few of our seniors a little later in the program. And of course, we're deeply invested in all the students dancing for as long as they can, but also having long careers. I am a former performer who made that pivot. And so personally, you said something to me a few weeks ago that really stayed with me about how, you know, you found yourself one week on the cover of the Times Arts and Leisure, and then the next week found that you couldn't pay your rent. So can you tell us about your journey? What made you pivot into this now next phase of your career, and what do you think are some of the most important experiences that will help you lead the company during this difficult time?
Yeah, that's such an important question. Like, how does an artist go through their trajectory? Like, what does that path look like? And it's so different for each of us. I was at a point in my career where, yeah, like you said, I was on the cover of the New York Times, like living my best life. And then we're, done for the next week. And, we were going to be done for like 6 months or something like that. We had a really long break coming up. And I was like, okay, so now what? Do I go back to waiting tables? Like that doesn't make sense for me. And like, I can't, at 40 years old, I couldn't do that anymore. I needed to do something different because that wasn't fulfilling. And I needed something that was continually fulfilling because the work, the José Limón work really fulfills me. It's like, you can't just take that away. So I went back to school and got my master's degree. And it was that moment of being really at such an apex, at such a climax, and then somewhere else the next day, that really was like, well, what is modern dance? And like, why is it that there can be such a climax and then the next day I'm walking dogs because I have to pay my rent? Why isn't this more important? And what do we need to do to make it more important? What do we need to do to continue to make it relevant every day? So there's a reason that we are performing and touring constantly. So that question just kept mulling over and over, and that was a part of my research. And that's when I started just digging and looking through the entire history of modern dance, and it was looking at how it was talked about in the 1920s and 30s, the way John Martin spoke about dance, the way he educated the audience. So when they walked into a theater, they knew or understand what they were about to see. And when they left, there were more conversations about what they just saw. So that discourse was there. And it really helped establish the foundation of this field that we have now. It's like, where would Martha Graham be without Louis Horst, without Edwin Denby, without these people who really situated us in a place to move us forward. So all of that research just opened my mind and then kept that investigation going. So when the company was looking for a new artistic director, I was fortunate enough to have just given my research to the board about all of this research about how to contextualize the work and different ways we can look at it and different ways we can bring it forward so it continues to be important and we continue to book more and tour more and teach more. So there's just more engaging on a regular basis. And fortunately that research is what opened the door for the position. And that is how I ended up here.
That's great. And you've led seamlessly into the next question. You've helped the interviewer so much. So obviously we've got a legacy company here that you're taking over artistic direction of. You clearly have not only an amazing encyclopedic knowledge of your history, but amazing respect for it. How do you balance drawing inspiration from all that history while putting your own voice on the company?
I think one of the aspects that draws me to figuring that out, and I think that's the fun part is figuring that out, is a collective approach. So I am not here by myself. You know, I am on the shoulders of my teachers that brought me up. I am in a space with the performers that I grew up with. So when I'm looking at these works and we're talking about them with the company and talking about how we're going to bring them forward, it's conversations with the generations that have been living in this work for longer than I have, so with the generation that actually worked with José. So those conversations, I think, will shed light and continue to shed light on how to move it forward. I was fortunate enough to stage a work called The Traitor at University of Florida 2 years ago. And the work had only ever been done by men. And I was interested in what it would look like if we told the story with men and women with a mixed gender ensemble. And Danny Lewis, who worked with José, was one of the OGs, right? One of the originals. He said, it can't be done. Like the weight and the story needs to be told through a male body because that's how it was choreographed. And he came and saw it and he looked at me and goes, I was wrong. You were right. He was like, it lives. He was like, that this work is so universal. It needs to be told from these other perspectives in order to shed light on the bigger meaning of what the work is. So it's these conversations that open up the possibilities of what the future can be.
That's great, thank you. So a great place to segue again, you mentioned standing on the shoulders of teachers. We're very fortunate here at Purchase to have a former member of the company on the faculty. So I'm thrilled to have us be joined by our colleague here at Purchase and your former company member, Sue Bernhard, who's gonna come in and join the conversation.
Hello.
Hi, Sue. Thank you for being here with us. We're glad to have you and have you join the conversation with Dante, both as a former Limón company member and as a professor here at the college. And I can say from your bio that you've danced and choreographed all over the world. I see you taught at Marymount where I went to school, but we can talk about that another time. So I want to talk to you guys about Limón's relationship to Purchase and young dancers in general. We had the company here just in February, right before the pandemic hit, and we were building a longer term relationship. And we're still building it. That's why this interview is happening. We're still building this relationship where the company would come here like we've been doing with many other companies and use it as a home to build work. And the benefit that we see as a college is that then you're embedded and you can help enrich the education that Sue is providing to our students in so many ways. So to start us off there, we're here at Purchase, huge performing arts tradition. What do you both see as the best relationship between presenting dance repertory as I do in the Performing Arts Center and the development of young artists? What's the best fusion we can make?
Well, I think it's happening. It was so exciting last year when Kristen Foote and Jonathan Rydell set that beautiful version of Psalm performed to live music. It was just stunning, and it was an amazing experience for the students to be able to be inside that work and touch that work. There's been Limón technique at Purchase since Purchase started, and we've had people emerge from the program into the company, but the technique develops, is so beautifully set to develop dancers for whatever technique they approach. It's couched in these principles that can be applied and give dancers range in any kind of movement that they want to approach. But I think it's so special to bring the company here, have the dancers really be able to see the work fully produced, to be able to experience the work through workshops with company members, as well as learning the repertoire. We've also had repertoire classes where they've learned pieces. And so it gives them a wide perspective, both on this aspect of their legacy, and also through the classes, seeing how the movement speaks to them and can help prepare them for their future as dancers.
Great, thank you. I imagine Dante, nothing to add to that, right?
Yeah, I mean, I can.
Great answer.
Yeah, I mean, that really covers it. I mean, I would love to echo how the work amplifies what the dancer already can do, and then gives them more, gives them that extra, gives them quality in a way that the Limón work does, you know, to fall and recover, to suspend and oppose those energies, those principles, apply beyond just the Limón technique and really flesh out a holistic dancer. And having that opportunity to touch the work, there's nothing like being able to live inside masterworks, because then you get the self-confidence. You're like, I just did that. I just brought a masterpiece back to life. I got to dance steps that someone danced 50 years ago. And that's why this college program exists, because of these works existed. So it's like, to live inside of that, I think there's no beating it.
So Dante, knowing that, to Sue's point, Limón technique already has such a presence here, as we build out the company's presence on campus, what sort of things do you think we can do beyond, obviously, the master classes and the students taking company classes and that sort of stuff? How can we go deeper?
I think mentorship is an important aspect. You know, I think about how I got here, and there wasn't that I was fortunate enough to be in the company when, you know, Carla Maxwell, the former artistic director, was finishing and still dancing a little bit, working with Roxanne d'Orléans-Just and Nina Watt, and these people who were, you know, are legends and icons, you know, they were still in the company. So I got to have that time with them, and I got that kind of mentorship. But that's no longer the case. It's a young company. Our most senior member has been in the company for 5 years. So they don't have that experience of working with someone who's been in the company for 30 years. So how do we prepare dancers who are going to go out into the world? I think it is that mentorship. So someone who has this position and is working and touring and living inside of this work, what can they share, and how can what they're learning implement and lift up that process from being a student in a college conservatory situation into the professional world?
Awesome, thank you. So in a bit, we're gonna be joined by two of our seniors. And one of the questions that always comes up when we do master classes, when we bring choreographers into class, is a version of how do I get into your company? Which is, I think, a natural question. What advice do each of you have for our seniors, and how has it changed given the current circumstances?
Well, I guess I'll jump in there. we do have students who've joined the company. We have three faculty members actually who danced with the company, and so I think that if they're interested in dancing with the Limón Company, they're certainly, you know, letting them know about workshops that they can take. Dante is continuing to think of ways to develop programs that sort of segue between the student world into the professional world. And so I think there'll be some exciting movement in that direction that can really be that sort of bridge. And I think that if they're interested in the work, you know, it's a company and there are only a certain amount of places open in that particular company, but it's also a community. And learning that, embedding yourself in that style and seeping in that style also prepares you to do work by people who are inspired by the company, who come out of the company, who are working, as Dante says, around some of the same concerns. So that sense of humanity within the work that so many people are drawn to is something else that they can move into through this training.
Yeah, I loved that she was, that Sue, you just mentioned working with those other choreographers that have come from this, because that's part of what the Limón world is about. You know, we present not only just Jose's work, but we also present work by other choreographers. So when we're looking at dancers coming into the company, well, what else are you bringing in your own artistry? Like, how are you as an artist walking into the space? How are you able to apply the principles not only to the Limón Humphrey vocabulary, but also how are you applying that those kinds of intentions to other vocabulary? So I can see a fully realized artist who is able to move from one style into the next. And I think another way, as we were just talking about, is those other programs. It's like, yeah, okay, you want to be in the company? I would love to have you in the company. How do we get you there? We have our Limón launch and approach training programs that happen throughout the year. Our summer and winter intensives, being engaged like that, so we get to know you better. We get to understand who you are. We get to help you develop yourself to see if this is even the right place for your artistry. Maybe going into the Doug Verone world is gonna suit you more. Maybe, you know, having that awareness and doing that research to know where you are going to want to land, I think, is also a part of it.
Great, thank you so much. So the last question for this section, I'm struck by what I haven't been in each of you, while some of us had, you know, there was reticence, concern, how do we train dancers virtually, which is a natural concern. Sue, I know you had to jump right in because of the timing of the shutdown. And the need to finish the spring semester. I think it's heroic what our faculty did, truly. And Dante, I know that the company jumped right in, as you said. You know, you started your job, you know, 4 months early because it was a critical moment. So to put a positive on the situation, what do you think the dance community can take from this virtual moment to use these tools to continue to provide high quality training to a wider range of artists?
Well, I think as Dante said, it's amazing the fact that you can teach a class and somebody, people from all over the world can take it. And that's just phenomenal. And I think, you know, to look at it even from a wider scope, we have a world right now that's so polarized. And I really think the artist sensibility is one thing that's going to heal us and bring us together. And so, okay, maybe the political world wants to stay fragmented, but the artistic world doesn't. It naturally coalesces and blossoms. So I think that's one thing. Another thing that I found actually teaching online is sometimes I can get a really specific, you know, it makes me tune into the student in a different way, perhaps make more effort, you know, I can pinpoint one student and really focus on them. So it also perhaps opens up some aspect of giving more individual attention, strangely enough, even though we're further apart. And then Dante and I were talking about this the other day. It's amazing what you can actually do in a small space, how you can kind of make it feel spacious, even though it's small. So that was a discovery as well.
I think that's wonderful. I mean, I would say for our small part, one of the things that's been very heartening is our ability to offer some enhancement by bringing in masterclasses with folks that are in California or somewhere else around the world that, you know, in normal times I would have had to fly them here and you know, spend a lot of budget. Whereas now it was an easy ask, actually, and they're all so happy to do it. So I found that remarkable. Great. Great. Well, thank you all very much. So I want to move to, as I said in the beginning, we've been working on this partnership with the Limón Company. We had a performance here that was one of the last performances before we shut down. And it was really to reintroduce, I should say, because obviously the audience has known the company, but the company hadn't been here in many years on the Performing Arts Center stages, despite its educational presence on the campus, which we thought was quite a miss. So we brought the company back. And we were fortunate enough to film that performance. So in a moment, we're going to show three excerpts from the performance that was in the PepsiCo Theater earlier this year. And we'll go through those. I invite you each to comment as you go. I'm curious, Sue, just your experience having been in the company and now seeing, you know, these pieces from just a few months ago. And Dante, as a new artistic director, be critical for us. What worked for you? What might you have done differently as you came into reintroducing the company to purchase? And you know, obviously, one of the things we want to do is keep people watching dance. So before we go into this and we get those comments, I'd love to just hear from you. You know, the dance audience is now forced to engage with a screen to see the work. Do you have any advice for viewing or how they might engage with the work in this format? Because I think we all know, I have a lot of conversations. We all have a lot of conversations in the lobby, especially at Modern Dance, of, well, what was I supposed to see? And that sort of stuff. And I love those conversations. I miss those conversations. It's different now. So what do you have any tips for how the audience should approach this virtual moment to keep watching dance?
Yeah, I think we can look at the bodies and see what the bodies are doing. When we're, you know, we've been talking about these principles and what does that mean? We've been talking about this idea of humanistic movement, a humanistic approach. What does that mean? So I would invite the audience to look at these performers as human beings who are experiencing a fall. So when they fall, is there actually weight that they're giving into that fall? And what is that feeling when the body is resisting gravity and starting to press against? What is that moment? And invest in what you see versus trying to find like a meaning behind the movement. Just relate to that person you're seeing on stage and look at their actions. Are they covering themselves? Are they opening themselves up? Are they pressing? Are they, you know, falling in? And what does that make you feel when you see that versus trying to say, oh, those things mean this? And maybe that's sort of the first step, is under getting a physical somatic understanding of what the bodies are doing. And I hope that might be a helpful.
I think that's hugely helpful. Thank you, Dante. Do you want to add anything to that, Sue?
I agree with that. I think that's the initial thing. Just trust, you know, just respond. Just trust yourself, your responses that you're feeling from the work, what you're getting from the work, you know, even on a physical level. Is it affecting, you know, are you finding some emotions bubbling up as you watch it?
Great. Very easy. So we're going to start, with a excerpt from Chacon, and I would welcome either of you to give it any quick intro that you want to, or we can just watch and feel free to comment. I'm not going to comment. I'm going to let the experts do that.
Yeah, José choreographed this before he even had a company. He was a very young choreographer when he created this. So I think that's important to keep in mind, that we are looking at what was originally created on an artist of color in the 1940s, a man, you know, and it wasn't as fashionable for men to be dancers. So there was a certain amount of athleticism a man had to show to prove that it was a man's place on stage as much as it was a woman's place on stage, because there wasn't really room for that. And the level of acceptance maybe wasn't as quite there yet.
Awesome. Thank you. And Ian, who's doing diligent work behind the scenes, go ahead.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
And she just handles that work so masterfully. You can just see the strength and determination, and the texture changes between the slow, sustained movement, and then all of a sudden she's swinging and flying through space. When do we do that in our own lives? When are we doing that right now? You know, it's like every day in quarantine is a year. You know, it's like you go through all of the emotions. So what is that as a dancer in that moment? You see that quiet, calm, the build, the release, the suspend, the run, the fall, and then going back and then thanking and being generous to your audience who's watching. You know, there's so many things in that little bit that I think offer so much to the audience.
Yeah, you know, earlier Dante brought up meditation, and when I look at that piece, I think about, you know, in meditation they talk about the war inside our minds, right? And always reacting to the hurricane instead of finding the quiet moment. And she finds both so beautifully.
Yeah. I mean, also that sense of human dignity, and as Dante said, also generosity. So there's like that center place from which everything's emanating out so beautifully into the space.
Yeah, she just said dignity, and I just want to underline that 1,000 times, the dignity of that work, and the importance it was for him to create that at that time.
And thank you for giving the audience the history, because I think that that is so critical as well in terms of when that piece was made, who it was made on, and where it came from. So we're going to go to a clip from Unsung.
No music here, the breath rhythm, the dancers are living together. This work is about the Native Americans and how their lands are being taken from them. You start off with a big group section and then it breaks into Here is where the rhythm of the Limón Dance works. It's creating a sport. Yeah, that's such a powerful work, you know, to be sitting in silence for, the piece can run almost a half hour. So you start off with the pantheon, and it's the eight dancers starting off, and then we have solos, and each dancer, each performer is telling their story about land being taken away and what that fight is like for each individual.
So I don't think, though, it will surprise either of you to know that some folks that night had some challenges with the silent piece, and we talked a lot about that in the lobby. So what might you say to someone who is thinking, well, I would have rather seen something with a score?
Maybe that's part of the introduction. You know, maybe it's inviting the audience to look for the music in the rhythm of their body, which is different than thinking you're sitting in silence versus actually engaging with the work and trying to find that dancer's rhythm and hearing it. So then it engages you in a different way if you're prepared, if you're given the right tools with which to look at the work.
Yeah, and I think it's not just in the stamping of the feet, but it's in the feeling of the breath. You know, can you allow yourself just to relax with it? And you'll find yourself sort of entering the fullness and the releases of what's happening there. And I also think, we might be at a time where, you know, we've got a lot going all the time, a lot of noise constantly. And so that's a very different space than people are used to. But the other thing is that, particularly in these group sections, they have to listen to each other. So you might say, well, notice how they're listening to each other, and moving is one body. They have to be so attuned. And, you know, what does that mean to tune into other people in a group to that degree?
And maybe that's also a conversation with the presenter. You know, maybe that's like, oh, are your audiences used to works in silence? And the presenter says, no. Okay, well, then maybe we don't show the whole work. Maybe we show the pantheon, and maybe we show two solos. So that way you get a taste and you start to develop the audience's ear. So the next time, you know, there are other works that are in silence. Carlotta is in silence. So maybe we build up to something like that. So then the audience starts to engage with it in a different way and you give them more tools and they have more time to understand what that is. And I think that's part of the education. I think that's part of what we're talking about when we're talking about building a long relationship. Okay, so it didn't work that night. So what could we do in the future? So we could present some of that work and it be effective. And I think that that's a continual conversation.
Absolutely. And I'm so glad you said it that way, Dante, because it's so important for audiences to know that it's such a partnership in every way, from deciding to bring a company to discussing what the program will be. You know, we discussed with myself included, gratefully, what that program would be over and over again. And your executive director, Juan José, and I reflected after the performance, and we did talk about what we could have done differently as a presenter. And what I thought is exactly what you just said. We had a chat with the audience after the show that evening, and I realized after the fact we should have done it before. So it's learning those things as a team. I completely agree.
It doesn't have to be a big thing. It's a 2-minute conversation. Maybe a film comes down and you see a little bit of rehearsal and you see that section that we just saw, but you hear someone singing the melody. Dee-da, dee-da, boom, ba, ba. So then you hear that happening in front of you. So then the screen goes up, the curtain opens, you see the dancers, that part happens and you go, oh, there it is.
Yep.
And then you're looking for it the rest of the time. So it's not even like you have to spoon feed it. It's intelligently crafting how you share that information. So the audience goes, oh, cool. I wouldn't have saw that before.
Yeah. And I love that you said that, because we never want to spoon feed it. We want people to come to it on their own. And I think, you know, we're so fortunate here at Purchase in that the reason we get a lot of dialogue is because we have a wonderfully trusting audience who comes and tries new things, which has been a great, great joy.
Yeah,
so,
I want them to love it. I want them to come back for more. So however we can do that in a way that is engaging, that's the mission.
So on the note of loving it, the last piece is one that I love, and I think from what Sue said, she loves. So we're going to see a excerpt from Psalm.
You have an outsider figure that's separate from the group, which is so often in that Limón tradition, in his narrative, and you get to see that there. But he was such a master at making the stage move and then craft and things coming in and out of each other, and then bam, you know, it's all aligned. It's masterful.
Yes.
Yeah, the architecture is such an expressive element in Auth's work.
Yeah, it's so clear there. That's why I wanted to show that piece that night. Before we move on, because we're so lucky to have these guests and we are all doing the real work, I have to thank Sue and say goodbye because she needs to go teach. So
wonderful to be here with you.
So thank you so much for joining us, Sue. It's such a pleasure. And I look forward to seeing you in the theater again when the days get good again.
Mm-hmm. Take care.
Bye. So yes, thank you, Dante. That piece, I felt that was the piece, and Juan José did too, and your predecessor as well. That was an important piece to show for exactly the reason you you said to me, as someone who has just watched Limón for years, it's such a signature important piece. Is that the entire company on stage at that point?
Should be. Yeah, that's full company there.
Yeah, it's just an amazing big piece. Well, thank you for sharing all of that with us. We're going to move on to the last segment of the interview, which is going to be some questions about working in the time of COVID. We think it's important educationally to establish that. And so to join us for that conversation, I'm grateful to have two of our wonderful seniors who are here on campus and doing what, in my opinion, in my colleagues' opinion, is an awe-inspiring job. They've been here since September amidst all the restrictions. They're going to class. They're doing it the right way. We have not had issues here at Purchase, and it's because of them. So I'm excited to introduce Avery and Caleb.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, guys. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
So I'm going to ask a few questions anyone can answer, and then at the end, I'm going to do what we think is the most important thing to do, which is I'm going to turn it over to the students, and Dante, they're going to ask you whatever they want to ask. So first, we understand, of course, that this is an inherently collaborative art form. Rehearsing as a group is so, so critical. Which is why I said what I said before, Avery and Caleb, it's such a gift to have you back on campus doing what you do. But you started in March in a virtual setting. I imagine you kept working over the summer in a virtual setting. And even now you're here, but I know, you know, many of the classes are here on our stages in the Performing Arts Center, and my amazing technical team has taped the squares, and you're distanced, and you're wearing your masks. So on both sides, what has it been like for the company to stay active and connected during this virtual time? And for Avery and Caleb, what has it been like first to continue your training on Zoom and then come back to this new environment?
I will say it is definitely such a blessing to be able to be on campus and be surrounded by people our age and dancers and other artists. And even though we are keeping our distance and we do have to follow all precautions, we're in our little squares dancing, it's wonderful to just have the opportunity to be in a dance studio. There's so many people who don't have that opportunity right now. And I think that transitioning Zoom is such a two-dimensional sort of playing field, and to be able to be in the studio and physically feel your body in like a 360 way is incredible.
Yeah, what I would piggyback off of that to say that I noticed how dependent I am within dance to be in close proximity with someone else. So to be in our own little boxes and not have that freedom to collaborate and to have contact with another dancer has been difficult. But it's just changing the way that I approach movement.
Awesome. And I should say for our audiences that Avery and Caleb are roommates, which is why they're not distanced, and it's all good. Dante, what about the company?
Well, I am very jealous that you guys get to hang out in the studio, so there's that. I am a really physical person, so like when I meet you, oh my gosh, how are you? So nice to meet you. And there's a hug involved, and there's a kiss, and there's a handshake, and there's contact. So yeah, really challenging moment in terms of just what I need, like as a person. Like it is important for me to have that human connection to like survive. It's oxygen for me. Other people fill me up, you know? It's like that exchange of energy is why I walk into the studio. Like I think one of the, you know, I was talking about the company, I'm like, what I miss most is walking into the studio, laying on the floor, rolling out my thigh, and then listening to like what other people are like binge watching, or what they're, you know, what song they're listening to, or what movie they just saw. And just like that little banter, that little chitter chatter before the rehearsal even starts that connects you in ways you're like, oh my God, I love that song too. Yes, we're listening to that after rehearsal on the subway ride home. You know, it's like, oh, I'll go watch that tonight. I'm missing all of that. So that's personal. In terms of the company, it's been all virtual. We have company class 2 to 3 days a week right now, all on Zoom. But starting December 1st, we will be up at Katzbahn. So we will actually be quarantining for 2 weeks and going up there, getting tested. And then we will be able to like rehearse and live and eat and listen to, you know, music and watch movies all together and put on a show, like, you know, we'll have a live stream performance at the end of that. So that's the trajectory. And that's what keeps me getting up every day being like, oh, we've got something awesome to look forward to.
Well, I'm so glad you're all doing it. And I would give you confidence on behalf of the audience that, you know, we miss our part too. I get to the great pleasure of doing a ton of scouting of work when things are normal. So I normally see dance 3-4 nights a week and I miss seeing it. And we have the students here and, you know, wonderful professors. Kimberly Bartosik is in the PepsiCo every day and so many great people, but we're being so careful that, you know, I can't even go in and experience dance. So it's really tough. But it's so wonderful to see what you're all doing. So Avery and Caleb, I asked Sue when she was here, and now I want to ask you, what are your plans senior year? It's a tough time. How has it changed? What do you see the trajectory as?
Yeah, absolutely. I think personally, it has kind of varied day to day and week to week. I think that now we're sort of mid-semester. I'm in a totally different headspace and mindset that I was coming in. I think it's taken a long time to sort of just adjusting being back here and sort of adjusting to the reality that this is our senior year and we are sort of transitioning into a whole new world that semi-exists right now but doesn't, which is super exciting but also super intimidating at the same time. So for the moment, it's definitely taking one day at a time and doing some soul searching and seeing what I want out of this career, how does dance benefit and provide to me, and how can I provide and benefit others through dance. So I think it's also an exciting opportunity to really take a step back from performing and training and all that sort of thing and really ask myself, okay, what specifically do I want to do? Where specifically do I want to go?
Yeah, awesome. Very similar. It's been a lot of self-investigation because you don't have the pressure of performing and putting out work in order to benefit someone else. So it's kind of just a lot of internal work that's been happening for all of us. It's been scary because we have senior seminar classes where we usually, the instructor gives us advice on how to navigate life after college. But there's such a new world that we're all navigating. So it's kind of hard to get advice on how to approach life post-grad.
It's interesting. I want to thank you both again for answering my questions and for being here. And now with whatever time we have left, I want to do what we get to do when times are normal and what not just myself, but my great, great team here at the PAC are so proud to do, probably most proud to do, which is give you access to the artists that we get to bring here to the Performing Arts Center. So here you are, the brand new artistic director of one of the most legendary companies in the history of dance. Ask him whatever you want.
Thank you so much. It's been so wonderful listening to you and Sue talk, and Seth as well, just kind of being students in the mindset of we're going out into the real world. So Dante, I know you talked a lot about the community engagement aspects of the Limón Company, which I know is a huge thing. And I think is something that right now, especially at this moment of time with the theaters closed, we don't have access to more privileged spaces. How do you think that this has given an opportunity for the Limón Company specifically to see gaps within that? And how have you thought about maybe taking the work outside of the proscenium stage and bringing it into new spaces? And if so, what types of spaces?
Great questions. I just want to say first what you guys were saying before about being a senior and entering into this world. You both you're so eloquent and so beautiful and so vulnerable in this moment because it is a really challenging moment, and just so much respect and compassion and love for what you guys are doing. You guys are the torchbearers and you guys are bringing dance forward. So thank you for continuing to do what you're doing. So community engagement. So fortunately over the summer, we were able to have our summer program called Limón Outdoors. So we go to Bryant Park and we teach Limón to who's ever on the lawn. Normally, we just show up, we have a section of the lawn that's kind of like reserved for us. We start teaching, and then people just sort of show up and then take a Limón class on a Saturday, and you know, it's a lot of fun for everyone. This year was so different because we couldn't do it for the first half of the summer, and then we were able to do it the second half of the summer, but we're like, who is going to show up? And then who, like, if you do, like, who's going to police that to make sure everyone stays? So it was very, like, nerve-wracking going in. We show up, we teach our class. We were at capacity. We were at, like, 50 people made their way there to come take Limón class on the Bryant Park lawn. I mean, everyone was socially distanced, everyone with their masks. We had, like, half of the lawn. I mean, nobody else was on the lawn but us. And it was the most amazing experience to just see like 50 bodies doing like the falls across the grass. And it was that moment. It was like, people need this and love this so much. How else can we continue to do that? And you're talking about bringing it outside the proscenium. Yes, absolutely. That is such a big part of what I want to do with this work. So I told you that, or you heard me talking about the live stream that we're going to be doing at Katzbahn in December. A moment like that, we're going to have the opportunity to have 3 or 4 cameras recording this. So you're going to be able to be like right here next to the dancer. You'll be able to like really be immersed in what they're doing. So it's no longer about seeing the company from this faraway place with this one camera in the back of the house. So even in this two-dimensional world, you're going to be right here with the dancer, hearing them breathe, seeing them sweat, and then pull back. And then maybe there's another camera that's off stage. So you really engage them in a new way. And that is exciting to me in terms of what we're able to offer now. Moving forward, there's no reason we can't bring the Moore's Pavane, you know, which is based on Othello, into a ballroom and make it like a Renaissance ball. So you're actually in the space and maybe you're chasing the characters from room to room. So you're having like that Sleep No More experience where you're really engaged and you can follow different stories and you can really stretch out and deconstruct what José created and then be involved with it. So you're in the space with them and you're walking around them while the action is happening. That to me is super exciting because I love this work and I want to make sure that you guys think it's dope too. And I want to present it in ways that you're like, yes, this is what we should be doing and this is how we should be doing it. So all across the board, that is the goal. And once we can start exploring what that is to actually be in a room together safely, that's going to be one of my first projects.
That is amazing. That sounds, as a student, that's so exciting to see such a classical company that's been around for forever and see it be able to branch off into new directions is so exciting. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, Dante, you spoke briefly about a piece you set on the University of Florida where you exchanged the men's role for the woman performing. And I think a really important issue when we're talking in terms of mid-century modern dance and beyond is not only how are we advocating for different racial identities within companies, but also different gender identities as well. So I was wondering, as artistic director, how do you plan on approaching different gender identities in terms of if someone is transgender or if they are male identifying but has the physical appearance of a female, how do you plan on honoring that gender identity but maintaining the integrity of Limón's work?
Fabulous question. Thank you so much. That's such an exciting aspect to start exploring. You know, it's been very binary, and José, even in the works, it was very male-female in terms of how those archetypes were developed and built around. And I think I'm so excited to see what that looks like on different bodies. So as you're saying with, when you brought up what I did at the University of Florida. So that piece, The Traitor, actually ends with, it's a story of Jesus and Judas, and it's really Judas's Gethsemane. It's him saying, why do I have to betray Jesus? So it's really told through his perspective. And I don't know if you know the story, but in the Bible, Judas hangs himself. So in the ballet, Judas also hangs himself, and there's a prop rope, and that's how the piece finishes. Very dramatic, very intense, really heart-wrenching because you really feel for this character. I set this on a mixed gender, and the dancer I set the Judas character, the traitor, on was a Haitian American. So to have a black body hanging from the rope at the end of a dance piece in the South gives a very different understanding of what that piece is or could be about. And we had that conversation, we had that discourse. It was like, do you feel comfortable doing that? And she was like, no, I don't feel comfortable doing that. And I go, I don't feel comfortable seeing it because I don't think it represents what we're trying, the story we're trying to tell here. And I think it takes it in a different direction. So we cut the prop rope. So we had to make that change. I was like, this doesn't make sense here in this was last year, so 2019. It doesn't make sense anymore. And I can't have that. And it's not what we're talking about in this moment. So allowing the work to evolve and morph and just depending on who are the artists in the room that are doing the work, I think is a really important aspect of how we move forward. And I'll give you another quick example. We'll be doing There Is a Time, and in There Is a Time, there's a section called Time to Embrace. Traditionally, it's always been done a man and a woman. There's no reason why we can't have two women doing it, or two men doing it, or if I have non-binary dancers in the company playing with those roles, it's not defined anymore. It's not necessary for me to uphold that, oh, these are the female roles, these are the male roles. No, these are artists that are performing ideas and intentions for you, and whoever is in this, whoever I'm sharing this space with, and whoever these performers are that is going to bring that intention out the most so you can see it, those are the artists that will be doing those roles.
Thank you for answering that.
Wonderful. What a wonderful conversation this has been. Well, unfortunately, I do have to wrap us up. I know we could stay all day, but I want to thank everyone. I want to thank Avery and Caleb, as I said before you came in. It's inspirational to us all what you're doing. Keep doing it, because you're the ones that are going to bring us back, and art will bring us back. So just keep working, and I want to thank Sue for giving up her time and her expertise for this, and Dante, of course. I want to make sure the audience knows we spend a lot of time on this, not just the hour that you see. We rehearse and make sure that we're right on, so thank you so much for all the time and the effort that you gave, and all the time and the effort that you're going to give to help make sure that, you know, the world heals through art. We can't wait to bring you back here to purchase, both to rehearse, we hope soon, but also for the experiences we're used to in the theater, because we have to do both, right? We need to keep doing this, but we need to get back in the theater when it's safe and when we can. So thank you all again so much. I wanna say to our audiences, we hope you enjoy this. We wanna keep providing for you through this difficult time. You can find this at heartcenter.org and on our YouTube channel. And as I always say, when we're in the theater, we're here to serve you. So we want to hear from you. We'd love to hear from you. And now more than ever, we'd love to hear from you. Thank you to my amazing team here who makes this all happen. And I wish everyone health and safety.